Get your phones and Bibles out. You've already been welcomed, and it's my privilege to share the word of the Lord today. Firstly, I want to make a specific welcome to the members of my family that are here today, and come a long way, some of them. My brother Barry's come all the way from New Zealand, and Brian and my other brothers come from New South Wales. And also we have my sister from Perth, and we welcome you guys, and her daughter Shelby, my sister Anne-Marie. It's been a wonderful weekend for the Rensfords. Amen. Matthew chapter 23. Let's get down to what really is important. And I think this word came to me when we first threw the idea out of having this reunion. I thought, you know, there are important stages in every person's life, and you can rank them, you can put them in order. The birth of a child, a marriage, a death, all kinds of things are important, and this has been one of the most important times of my life. Verse 23. He's telling off people here. Jesus wasn't always Mr. Nice Guy when he had to do stuff to straighten stuff out. He was pretty straight. And he said, you bunch of rat bags, basically. Woe to you teachers, the law of the Pharisees, hypocrites. You give your tithes, and that's what we should do, by the way. We believe in tithing and here, and if there's offering boxes at the back, we don't actually take up offerings. If you're new, it's kind of weird not to be asked for money, but that's all right. We still want it, but just stick it in the back or put it online, something like that. Got to run the place. But they did this really, you know, so legalistic about their money. But, he goes, you've neglected the more important matters of the law. Justice, mercy and faithfulness. And Jeremy was leading into that when he was reading that passage out of Corinthians. These are the important things. And it's easy to be legalistic and say, oh, you got to do this, you got to do that. But Jesus is saying, no, the important things, it's what's inside of us. That's what's important, the mercy side of our lives. And so I went through it and I thought, well, Keith, what is important to you? And I came up with five things. And those three represent them, justice, mercy and faithfulness. I did a bit of research. I asked a few folk from our church, our small group. I surveyed our small group, and thanks you guys for the help you gave me. And I said to them, what's important to you? And it's interesting the responses you get. Many are similar, but not all. And I think if we ask a Christian that question, you might get a different response perhaps than you would if you ask people out there that are in the world doing their thing. Because I think we need to decide what is really more important to us. And it shouldn't necessarily be about us, as you already pointed out, son. So what isn't it? I thought, well, some of the responses I've got back that are out there, these things are not necessarily bad in themselves, but they don't rank as highly in the order of importance as the things of God. So what doesn't? Okay, people talk about their feelings. Our feelings are there, but they're not important. Worldliness, the things that we accumulate and the things we enjoy that are of the world, and they're good. I mean, how many are watching the football this afternoon? Well, that's good, that's worldly, but it's not as... Oh, I can't believe I'm saying this. It's not important. Jordan. Relationships, my girlfriend, my boyfriend, whatever. What did I say? Worldliness, personal ambition, getting a better job, whatever. It's good, but it shouldn't rank. Leisure, going on holidays, it's all good. But for me, that doesn't rank. Money. If money ranks as top, then the guy without the money, he's down there somewhere. My job. Oh, if I lost my job, I'm in terrible fear. I was talking to somebody just before service, and I promised them I'd pray that they get a job. We believe in God as a congregation, and that young man's going to get the job that God wants for him. And I, part of the survey when I got back stuff from the folk was what is important, and I didn't list these, but they are. One of the ones that comes up frequently is health. People saying that we have many here in the medical profession, and you know how important people feel that their health is, especially when you're getting grey hair and knees that don't work, all those kind of things. Yeah, health. Discernment, somebody said. Relationships was another one. And so I want to go through the five things that to me, and these rank in order of importance. And it flows into what Jeremy has said. How many of you enjoyed the, I shouldn't ask for hands because you feel obliged to put it up, but I think we all enjoyed the series that we've had recently leading up to Easter, where we talked about humility, we talked about the blood, and I especially appreciated Daniel, who's doing that, aren't you, Daniel? Thanks, buddy. He does all this stuff anyway, typing things out. Last week, how powerful that was. And I sat there listening to that, thinking, Lord, you're so good. You always confirm your word. And much of what, not all, but much of what Daniel said last week just flowed straight into what I want to say today. And I'm so appreciative of how the Holy Spirit works. I asked this lady sitting in the second row here if I could talk about her to start with today. How many people have Filipino heritage? Yeah, hands up. There's a lot of my family. Look at them all. Filipino heritage, a lot of you. I wish I knew a bit of Tagalog, but I don't. I always get Telugu and Tagalog mixed up. The Telugu is Indian, isn't it?
Yes.
And they have wonderful names, don't they? Queenly. Don't they? Libeth. Don't they? Lovejoy. How's that for a cool name? Doesn't that have everything in it? And that's my first priority, is Lovejoy. Not you personally, you're on the list. Maybe not as important as the other half Filipino sitting in that row beside my brother. But wonderful name. That is of a real importance to me. And that word love, it comes right through the whole five, obviously. God is love, and everyone that loves is of God. So love, but joy. I promised myself I wouldn't get emotional, but it means that's joy in my life. It just overflows. That's why you get emotional. Because joy is an incredibly important thing. And I added a little thing in there that goes with joy, and that's humour. You know, I'm really looking forward to dying. Amen? No? Okay, stay with me. Because I'm going to meet Jesus and I'll be standing in front of the Father. And I've always had a really deep suspicion, and I can't find it in the Bible very much, but I sincerely believe guys have got an incredible sense of humour. I mean, looking out here, I can see that already, but that's just, no, don't take it personally. He's so funny. You know, because the closer I get to him, and the closer my family becomes to me, the more humour there is. I had to kind of apologise to Anne-Marie. I said, look, they're not putting on an act. They're always like this. You should be ashamed of yourself, Zach. You know, his sense of humour, it almost borders on the insane sometimes. It's just so unbelievable. Don't you start. Sorry, but I'm trying to keep it. The Lord said to me, keep it away from your family. He obviously said it to Jeremy. This isn't about our family. I'm trying to instruct this for your family. And please, you dads, keep... There's nothing better than dad jokes. Jeremy's terrible jokes that he tells to warm up the crowd. Don't ever stop doing that, son. I can't believe I said that either, but don't ever stop with the jokes. Don't ever stop with the humour. The humour is the gel of my family. It is. Would you agree with that, Ariel? I hear some jokes back there. Oh, get out of here. Let's get some scripture to justify it. Proverbs. Just because Western's... Proverbs chapter 4. I might have left that one off there, Daniel, sorry. Sorry, Psalm chapter 4. And then we'll go to Proverbs. Oh, yeah, there it is. Sorry, I'm racing ahead a little bit. Just to introductory scriptures. You have filled my heart with greater joy than when the grain and the new wine appear. So when you got a harvest, that's the time of great joy. That's when they all celebrated back in the Bible times. When the harvest comes in the last days, which I predict will be soon, where the greatest revival the world will ever see. I know Jeff Hammond agrees with me. The whole world is going to see the greatest revival the world has ever seen. That's not far off. And if you think there's ever going to be a time of rejoicing, a time of greater joy. Like, we got joy, but he's prophesying a greater joy. That's about to hit the world. Off track, I know, but I couldn't help myself. Proverbs chapter 17. I want to back up these things with the word of God, because without that, it's just the thoughts of Chairman Keith. Verse 22. A cheerful heart is a good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. There you are. The word of God is backing up what we're saying. Joy is important. Humor is important. Love is over them all. And I won't turn to Nehemiah chapter 8. I never knew that scripture. We used to sing it. The joy of the Lord is my strength. How many remember that song? How many remember the special chorus? Ha, 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 ha. That's the weirdest song you ever sing in church. Somebody comes in and they go, well, they're going to sing these lovely old psalms. And they go, ha, 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 ha. What was that, Linda? Linda's very strict. If we get out of line, she won't let us get out of line. And I think you inherited that gene, though. And then we want to make sure that we ha-ha a little bit, but maybe not over the top, put people off. You know, you're not your favourite chorus, Linda. Okay, that's all right. The joy of the Lord is my strength. So what's going to happen when you have joy? It strengthens you. When we have fun, we have joy, we have humour, and our family strengthens our family. We have glue that holds us together. We need to be glued together. We need the body of Christ to be glued together. We need the church of Jesus Christ to be that kind of church. It isn't just about my family, it's about this family, the family of God. It's not just about this church, it's about every church in Shepparton, that they be glued together, that we be glued to them. Let's not be selfish as a family. Let's not be selfish as a church. Let's not be selfish as a church community in Shepparton. Let's show that joy, that love. And God's been good to do that for us. Second most important thing I put down is purpose. We're going to get that first reference from Philippians chapter 2. It's obvious I looked up the word purpose and cheated a bit, but hey, what are you going to do? That's why I do all the work and get all the money. That was a joke, by the way. I'm on the pension. Then make my joy, interesting, links it in, complete by being like-minded, having the same love, joy, being one in spirit and purpose. And I want to say to you, young people, today there is a catastrophe going on in our community of mental health. Many here in this community work in the areas of mental health, work in the psychiatric centre or medical facilities. And you know that young people are hugely represented in mental health facilities. And I came to the Lord in 1967. And I said to my family yesterday, one thing I thank is my brother Brian, who became a Christian at the Teatro Baptist Church back in 66 probably, and nagged me and left little things around the house for me to read. And he thought I wasn't reading them, but when he wasn't looking, I was sneaking. That was all the religious stuff Brian's into. And he used to go into the room and pray. And I'd sneak up to the door and listen. because he was praying in this weird language, he reckons. I speak in tongues. It's not really Baptist of him, but he was. And I got interested. And he asked me to come to a prayer meeting. Why did you ask me to a prayer meeting? You should have got me to church. Well, he probably did, but I wouldn't go. I was too busy on the grog and all the worldly things. So I went to this prayer meeting, and it was a Pentecostal prayer meeting. Never be ashamed of your faith. If people are hungry, they'll get through the weirdness because Jesus is through that. And he said to me when we drove home, what do you think, Keith? I said, well, it was a bit like the seances that I go to, and it was kind of good. Do you remember me saying that? Probably don't. But I was into the occult. I needed to be taken from a deep and dark place into where I am today. How good is God? And so it was only later, about 6 months later, this is towards this point of purpose, and I want to talk to young people about being at the age of 19. 19 is a critical age. Parents, be extra vigilant for your kids when they turn 19, because I didn't have that kind of care from my parents. I mean, I believe they loved me, but they didn't know this stuff. People don't know this stuff. Unless you come to church or do a bit of research, you don't know. So that kid comes to the age of their teenage years, and they're going to be an adult, and especially young men start saying, what's it all about? Why am I here? I remember lying in bed and getting the hair on the back of my neck coming up with fear about eternity, about the issues that were way beyond my comprehension as a teenager, and in my adult life I'm entering into. I'm thinking, what's the point? And things started to go wrong, and my car broke down, all these things were happening, and I thought to myself, there's no point. What is the point of life? What is its purpose? And so many, every young person to some degree out there right now is asking that very question. Particularly at that age, but it goes on through. If they don't deal with it, it goes through into the early 30s. And drugs don't help. They exacerbate it. And thankfully, my brother nagged me and said, he had another go. He hadn't given up on me. Nor had the church. They'd been praying for me for 6 months. The moment I was in that prayer meeting, they got going. And they stormed the battlements of heaven, just like we do here. That's why many of you are here, because we prayed you into this place so you could find Jesus just like we have. So I went, and the Holy Spirit, many of you have heard my testimony, but I realize many of you haven't. Who's this old bloke up the front? Well, this is me, and this is why. So they said, anybody, I listened, and the pastor had written a song, and it was taken from Corinthians, from glory to glory, he's changing me. Did anyone sing that back in the 60s? It became quite popular, went around the place. And I thought, those are interesting words. If anybody needed to hear that song, it was me. I believe God gave that song to that pastor because I was going to walk into his church. From earthly things to the heavenly, his likeness and image to perfect in me, the love of God shown to the world. He's changing me. And so I walked, Brian nudged me, and he knew I was oppressed by the devil, and he said, Keith, get up the front, get prayer for that. And I thought, well, what the, you know what? What the heck? He pushed me off my chair. And the moment I walked into that aisle, the Holy Spirit came on me like a powerful force, and the tears were running down my face. I still remember it so graphically today. And I got up to the front, this sobbing, tattooed, long-haired delinquent, got up to the front of the church, and the poor old pastor looked at me and said, what do you want? He didn't know what he got. And I said, I don't know. I guess pray for me. So they laid hands on me, and I began speaking in tongues like that. Even though what it was. But God was cleansing me by the Holy Spirit through and through. I never changed. I've never walked back. I've never turned my back on Jesus to this day, and I never will. Because of what he's done, because of what Jeremy described, the curse was broken. So it's important to have a purpose. And that day, January the 20th, 1967, that's the most important day of my life. That day I found my purpose. And it was to serve him, and I've done it ever since. And I listen to my family, I think of the stories, and I look at this place, and I think, this is all because of one day. What's your purpose? What's your day? What's God got for you? Especially speaking to you young people. You listening back there? I can see you are. Even Lockie's listening. He's in our family. And that's my third one. I had here Hebrews 11:8 about Abraham, but I'll have to skip that. My sister got baptized last Sunday. I think that's a wonderful thing. We praise God for that, Anne Marie. And like in our church, we give people scriptures when they get baptized. And our family sent some scriptures to her. I just want to explain to you the one I sent you. It's from Ephesians 3:15. It says, "For this reason, I bow my knee before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family..." It's the only time the word family is mentioned in the New Testament. Amazing, isn't it, when you think of it? "Of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." There's something about family and the name of a family that is important. Because we belong to a family, and that family is named by the name the Lord Jesus Christ. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. His name is given to us as a family. Are you proud of that? You know, there are a lot of controversy around, and I want to say something about names today. Names are important. They were first called Christians at Antioch. It's in the Bible. Never changed from that. We are Christians. We're not Messianic ones. We're not Kiwi ones. We're not baseball ones. We're not black ones. We're not white ones. We are Christians. So that name's important. It's important to me, that's why I think it's important for me to say what that means to me. And so, as you discover your purpose, and as you discover your true family, which is your own family first, but also the family of God, every family has a legacy. And I want to say that I believe God has provided a wonderful legacy for any family that comes to him. The last two, Luke chapter 12, introduces this one, verse 31. You're very familiar scripture, but you need to read it. "But seek first his kingdom, and these things will be added to you." How important is his kingdom to you, to me? It's everything. I mean, my family will eventually pass away. Go to any cemetery and have a look. Go to the Waikamuti Cemetery in New Lynn, Auckland, where you'll find the Rensfords are buried. I always try and go there if I'm in Auckland and clean up the graves. I think it's important to pay respect to the family. You can go out to Tulamba when I go, "No, it's cheap." We're having an argument right in the middle of my sermon about chipboard too. So. Anyway, getting sidetracked. But that's our family, my grandfathers and all the Rensfords, a lot of them are buried there. So our name is important, but it means nothing compared to his name. And the kingdom of God, when that happened to me, it just seemed to me that was the most important thing that I could think of. The scripture I wrote for that is taken from Romans chapter 12. I think this is the second last scripture. And I think someone referred to Romans 12. It's amazing the way God confirms his word. Verse 11, he's talking about love here. Again, this theme of love runs right through everything that I've come across. But Romans chapter 12 and verse 11 says, Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. It implies that you can lose it. And I've seen many over the years that have lost their spiritual fervor and lost their zeal. The moment you do that, you're turning from this direction that repentance takes us in to another direction, and it's going to swing the opposite. So you need to keep your spiritual zeal. The kingdom motivates me. I am passionate for the kingdom. It's what I think about. I was trying to think of what's an illustration of being passionate for God's kingdom. I'll give you an example. When I come along here on a Sunday, and last week, I won't say who she is, but she got red and she's sitting at the back, came in. This lady had been at the outreach and we'd prayed for her, and she came into our church and she'd committed her life to the Lord. I wept. I was excited. The whole church, to me, just zeroed in on that one person because I'm zealous for the kingdom. That's what the kingdom is. It's just somebody that needs the touch of Jesus, and he does it. And you think, wow, all the rest of you didn't matter when I saw her. You're slowly coming back to me. But you know what I mean? It's just so, I'm so zealous. You could say, all you do is think about the church. Yeah, because we're the representation of the kingdom on earth and to this city. The church is important. I'm zealous for the church, but not just this one, all of the church of Jesus. And I appreciate that Jeremy's always had that same vision. In fact, he's way better at it than I am, of networking the churches. He's gone on way further than I ever did in my endeavours, because God's got a plan for this city, and it's all about the kingdom. And if you think the kingdom is this church, you're mistaken. The kingdom is out there to embrace every unbeliever, to bring them in. I don't care if it's the AOG or the Church of Christ. I don't care. Just bring them in, Lord. Because we got plenty of room for everybody. The word zeal, jealous there, I think it's the word zeal and zealous. It's the direct Greek, same word, zeal, zealous. It's the same word in Greek. That's how important it is to be jealous for God. I don't want the devil getting the glory. The last one, and Jeremy finished with this. I don't think I need to turn for it. For those of you that are familiar with the Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, most of you could quote it, I'm sure. For God has put what in our hearts? Eternity. The most important thing to me, above and beyond what we have talked about today, is eternity with Jesus. And as I referred to, my own journey into faith involved being confronted with the prospect of eternity. It was just too much for me to imagine. I was lying in my bed thinking, okay, I'm alive now, but soon or late I'm going to die. That's it? Is it really that's it? And if that's it, what on earth is the point? Why do we struggle with this? Alfred. Everyone in our family knows who Alfred is. He was involved in our celebration yesterday. But we had to put him outside so he could have a wee and go to the toilet. So he's a dog. I'm glad you've got that, because you're starting to worry. When he does what he does, has his tea and then goes to sleep, he's not thinking about eternity. He's really not, trust me. Very short attention span, I'm getting fed back here. Why is it? Why do men and women think, what's life really about? Is it about doggy bones, water, lady doggies? Come on, you all know it's true.
You can't say that.
You can't say that, she told me. Why is it? Because God put eternity in your heart and mine. And if you don't know the salvation that is provided through Jesus Christ, you are always going to live in a place of mental torment to some degree or other. If we could just get people who are tormented to realize that God loves them and he's designed them for a purpose to live in eternity with him, we wouldn't have crazy people. I wouldn't have gone. I would have gone crazy. Honestly, you'd have to lock me up because I needed to know. But once you know, you're assured. And then when I began to read the Bible, I dropped the lump of concrete at work, came, smashed me to pieces, and I sat down there in that hospital for 3 weeks looking at my gangrenous foot, and God gave me a Gideon's Bible that I'd stolen from a motor camp. That's what you do. It was a book, and it was free, and I took it. Didn't know it was even a Bible, and Gideon's used that testimony to this day. They don't mind. And I read my Gideon's Bible, and I read. And I discovered there's a reason for eternity, and all the answers are in that book. And I'm still reading and finding out the answers today. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so if you're here today and you've never made that commitment to Christ, it's been a bit evangelical today because God wants to get at something in our hearts, not just the person standing there that's not really assured of their salvation, but for all of us. If we don't get the concept of eternity, we're not going to go out there and rescue the perishing. We're not going to snatch them from the jaws of death because we know they're going into a lost eternity. And you know the alternative. This is a fire and brimstone finish. They're going to hell where for eternity they burn in torment because that's what the devil was consigned for. And until they realize there's forgiveness to get them out of there, they're heading for the same place. That should motivate us who understand what eternity is about to do something about it, to do something about our neighbors, to do something for that old guy I've been talking to, what I've been walking in the mornings. He needs to come to Christ because he's a lot closer than Eli is. Or Caleb, picking on a couple of young ones. Anyway, I'm done. I'm going to pray. I want to pray that all of us today would understand the importance of putting Jesus first. And I want us to make a commitment. I'm not saying you're all backslidden, but we all need to reaffirm and recommit. And today, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand together. You have to, right? Unless you're completely crippled. And then by faith of standing in your heart. To be able to just say, I want to put you first. But before we do, I'm out praying, saying, Lord, I want to pray for that. I want everybody to stand. Is that okay? He goes, yeah, go ahead. And he said, by the way, diverticulitis or some name like that. I'm thinking, what? Okay. So I'm saying that name. I don't know why. Is it some kind of disease or something? Huh? She's pointing at her stomach. Okay. Something to do with your stomach. Maybe if you've been diagnosed with that, God wants to heal you. The Word of God promises that he will follow up his word with signs and wonders. It would be a sign and a wonder if you got healed of that, wouldn't it? We've seen, yeah, sorry. Yep, come out here. Look, do you mind? Grab the microphone. We want the Holy Spirit just to finish off doing what he does. I'll take this one here, thanks. Who's up there? Adam? It's coming. There it is.
Okay. I've had this on my heart through for a week or so, and I really felt it was for this morning, but the Holy Spirit has had such a beautiful presence this morning. Mm. I thought, I don't want to interrupt. I thought, Lord, give me, if you really want it, give me an opportunity. And it's about perspective, a person's perspective and the way they look at things. But it was, and I had this thing that kept going round and round in my heart and my life, and I kept looking at it the same way, and it was a very negative attitude that I had about how I was doing and how I was going in myself, and I felt like if I keep this up I will come under condemnation. Mm. It was like that. It just kept me in this same spot, and perception was the other word he gave me, perspective and perception. And the Lord said to me, Deborah, You are looking at yourself through your own eyes. Mm. You are not looking at yourself as I see you. Mm. And so therefore, you will sit under this thing as long as you do not change your perspective mm-hmm. or your perception. Mm. And perspective means, this is how he explained it to me, how I am and where I'm looking out. Perception has to do with my own thing of how I look at me. Mm. And he was saying, you need to see who you are in me and through me. There is nothing in me looks at you like you are looking at yourself. You need to look at who you are in Christ, yeah. covered by the blood of Christ, washed clean, made whole, in his strength, in his victory. We heard all these things this morning in the prayer meeting about chains dropping. I feel like this is scales That's dropping right. off people's eyes, mm-hmm. that we must stop looking at ourselves over and over and over again in what we see as a fault or a shortcoming in ourselves, because he has dealt with them all, every single one. We really need to know who we are in him. And he said, when you look at yourself through my eyes, through how I see you, you will see me as I am and you will see other people as I see
that's
them.
Good. Thank you very much. Praise God. So if that applies to you, we're going to finish off by praying for those needs that the Lord has pointed out. I think connected to that, Debbie, would be a spirit of rejection and condemnation. And I was talking to someone in my family just this week about someone that's not here and I've never met, but there's a spirit of rejection on them. And I feel because that's important, it's been brought up, we're going to pray for that. But that will include others here today. So let's just close our eyes before we stand together. And if anybody here, what Debbie has said and what I've shared about that, if that applies to you, could you put your hand up just to let me know that I am praying right? Good, that's good. Any others? Yes, thank you. Yes, oh man, that's a lot. Yes, yes, yes. Wow, okay. In Jesus' name, we take authority over the spirit of rejection, the spirit of condemnation. Satan, we bind you. We send you to Perth, Holy Spirit. And take care of the spirit of rejection over this one, even there. Right now, we know you're moving. I sense that in the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Now, Lord, when you remove something negative, you put the positive in by the Holy Spirit and replace rejection with acceptance, with perspective, as Debbie said, the true perspective, the God perspective. And the condemnation must go. Let conviction stay, because that's what the Holy Spirit does. But he does it in love. He does it with encouragement. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to overcome these things. And that diverticulitis still sits with me. Anybody got something like that? I might have got it wrong, but you feel it. Okay, good. Okay. Oh, I know what you mean. And that one there. Oh, there's quite a few. That's amazing. I never heard of it. I must have. Anyway, Lord, you know, you're a great God. Healing. Let healing flow right now in Jesus' name. Speak your word of healing over their lives. Set the stomach, whatever it is, set it right by the power of the Holy Spirit. Take pain away, take discomfort away in the name of Jesus. Now, can you please stand with me? We're going to commit ourselves to putting him first. Quick prayer. Let's all stand. Father God, did you have something to say? Yeah, the woman always has to have the last say. That's the story. Make it quick, sorry.
Going to pray, I'll let him do that. But when Jeremy was preaching speaking during communion about the many and the one, and he was talking about everybody, the Lord looks at everybody, but he looks at the individual. But there's a day coming when the many will be one. That's one church, one body made up of individuals, but one church.
Yes.
Can we believe for that? And Amen. You know, if you're that sort of person who likes to be just that little bit different and not really connected, you'll miss out. Because Jesus prayed that they may be one as you and I are one, Father. How much closer can you get than that? So though we be many, one day we will be one.
Amen. Father God, we just pray that we, your people of God, would be one, truly one in purpose. One in unity, and one in our zeal and desire to put you first. Lord, for every decision, every thought, every pathway we might be looking at, we know that when we put you first, we end up full of joy, full of love, full of purpose, full of everything that anyone can desire, full of a hope for glory. Thank you, Father. We make that commitment today. We're going to put you first. We pray. Amen. You may be seated, and we've got some good treats out the back. Linda, are you shutting off, or am I shutting off? I'm shutting off. Bye. Come back soon.